Let me take you to section 17 first. From section 1, we are into which act?
CGST
Act 2017. Alright, in this act we have discussed section 1. Section 1, scope, extent, title and applicability. It extends to whole of India. Applicability, everybody knows, 17-2017. Am I clear? Section 2, definition. Section 3, 4, 5, 6, power of authority. Section 7, supply. That we have 7-1, 7-2, 7-3. Alright, 7-1 is divided into A, B, C, D. Alright, then section 8. Section 8 is divided into two parts. 8A, 8B. 8A composite supply, 8B mixed supply. Section 9 is the levy section, charging section. That is divided into 5 subsections. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And 1 is the basic levy. 2 says levy will be there in future on petroleum product. 3 is a reverse charge mechanism. 4, reverse charge but unregistered to registered. And 5 is e-commerce operator. Am I clear? Then section 10, composition. Hello, composition levy is a levy, part of levy, but composition, alternative levy. You understand? Right? Section 11, exemption, either by exemption order or exemption notification. Okay? That is section 11. Section 12, time of supply of goods. Hello, section 12, time of supply of goods. Section 13, time of supply of services. Both these sections are divided into 6 subsections. And we have discussed that. Section 14, I did not mention. Only reason because it is not there in IPCC syllabus. But for CMA and CS, they should understand what is there in section 14 also. Section 14 talks about whenever there is a change. Okay, GST law is not a stable law. It's a changing law, continuous changing law. Alright, so when you took admission in classroom, please understand, when you took admission in classroom, say for example, our services were taxable at 18%. Alright, but when you came here to pay, that time service tax, this GST rate was 12%. Just assume that, okay? Or when you place order with me for a particular commodity, that time rate was 18%. Alright, later on government changed it to 12%. Hello, this can happen, isn't it? Yeah, earlier it was in 28%, now it is in 18%. Earlier it was in 28%, now it is in 12%. There are possibilities. Out of possibility, we are having three main unit. Alright, three main particular dates. Date of supply. Alright, date of supply. Then we are having date of invoice and date of payment. Hello, date of payment. These three important dates we have. Date of supply, date of invoice and date of payment. If out of these three, any two falls between after a date. Hello, if all three falls before change, all three fall before change, then obviously I will follow 18%. Alright, if all three falls after change, obviously I will follow 12%. There is no confusion as such. There will be confusion if invoice has been issued but payment is due. Alright, so services has been provided but invoice was not issued. So whenever there will be difference between this particular, that some event has happened before change and some event are yet to happen after change. Okay, so there will be confusion that which rate we have to follow. Shall we follow new rate or old rate? Hello, yeah, before change or after change. Rule is very simple, majority wins. Majority wins. Out of three, two is the majority. Hello, so if two are before, any two are before, then old rate. Any two are after, new rate. Hello, any two before, old rate. Any two of this, new rate. Sir, all three before, obviously old rate. Alright, all three after, obviously new rate. Only confusion will be there if date of invoice is before and this date of services and date of payment is after. So after, no, two events are after, so new rate. Am I clear? Only old new it is there in section 14. That's why we haven't discussed section 14. Today I discuss for other batch. Alright, section 15, yesterday we discussed and in 2 hours discussion we had completed whole chapter, and that was value of supply. Very very important chapter that we had discussed yesterday. Value of supply. How do we do valuation? So value is a transaction value. Value is equal to transaction value. Transaction value means price actually paid or payable. To accept transaction value, you have two conditions to fulfill. Buyer and seller are not related and price is a sole consideration. Sir, if these two conditions are not complied, then you have to travel to valuation rules. Valuation rules are not there in the syllabus of CS executive as well as IPCC. It is there in CMA syllabus that we may discuss later on. Okay. Next, CMA syllabus is like unlimited syllabus. Then like endless syllabus. Next, second section was, next section that we started yesterday after break was section 16. 16 was input tax credit. Hello, 16 was input tax credit. Basis about input tax credit. What are the conditions to avail input tax credit? So I prepared one chart here. You know, these are the different types of input. A person should be registered one. Goods has to be received. Tax has to be paid. Return has to be filed. Hello? He must purchase valid tax invoice or debit note or any prescribed document which includes bill of entry and tax, challan in case of reverse charge mechanism. We have discussed all those things. Alright. Apart from that, yesterday lectures, we haven't discussed much about input tax credit because today is the reason for input tax credit. Yesterday we haven't discussed anything about, and assume that we haven't discussed anything about input tax credit. Main discussion of input tax credit is happening today. Okay, basic rule you already know that IGST can be used against IGST, CGST and HGST. CGST can be used against CGST or IGST. HGST can be used against HGST or IGST. You understand this? But CGST cannot be used against SGST and HGST cannot be used against. This rule you already know. That's what, like, yesterday was not substantial discussion on input tax credit. Today we are going to do substantial discussion on input tax credit. Are we clear about it? Yeah. Now, yesterday, instead of discussing input tax credit, I discussed three more chapters that we are having in syllabus. Alright, invoices, alright, tax payments and main returns. Main chapter that we discussed yesterday was returns. We have discussed three to four returns minimum. Alright, the first return has to be filed by 10th of the following month, and that is GSTR1, that is sales return. Alright, the moment you file sales return, your e-credit, e-liability ledger will be generated. Alright, after 10th, that means 11th to 15th, you have to file your GSTR2. But GSTR2 you don't file, you just accept it or modify it from GSTR2A, which has been created from GSTR1 of your supplier. Alright, after you preparing GSTR2, if there are some modification, then notification has to go to your supplier, that will be delivered to him in GSTR1A, which he has to accept on 16 and 17. All right then, what, after completing these transactions, whoever is registered in GST, everyone will file one return, and that is GSTR3. If GSTR1, 2 dates are delayed from government's angle, all right then there is an alternative return for payment of tax, and that is GSTR3B. All right if you are a composition dealer, then for you, returns are not monthly, returns are quarterly, and that's why you have to file quarterly return before 18th of following month, when quarter ends 18th, right? And that form was GSTR4. And then you have to file annual return of GST, and annual return of GST will be that is, number is GSTR9, and due date of annual return is 31st December 2000, like for you it is 18 is going on 31st December 2018. For 17-18, 31st December 2018. For 17-18, 31st March 2018, this is the last day for this. 31st March 2018 is the due date of annual return. Am I clear? Yeah. All this return data you should keep in your mind, so that we will be using it here. Some of the discussions will be based on those returns and everything. From input tax credit, where do we show it? Like, from in which, through which return you get input tax credit in your system? GSTR2. GSTR2 will create what? E-credit ledger. Hello. GSTR2 will create e-credit ledger. Now you have to check your e-liability ledgers and e-credit ledger. If e-liability ledger is more than e-credit ledger, then you have to pay tax in cash. You can't pay directly to government department. First, you have to add that cash to your e-cash ledger. From your bank account, it will go to your e-cash ledger. From e-cash ledger, you will utilize for payment of your final obligation in GSTR3. Am I clear? Yeah. So these three ledgers are also important: e-liability ledger, e-credit ledger, and e-cash ledger. All these three ledgers are maintained online. Nothing is maintained offline, and that is on GST Common Portal. All right, www.gst.gov.in. This is a website where it is maintained. Am I clear? Yeah. So everything is happening online here. That's why human intervention is very low. That's why everything, whatever happening in my GST law, can be cross-checked here, and that's why there are concept of matching and mismatching. Matching and
mismatching.
The moment I claim ITC, government automatically, the server automatically match it with the tax paid by my supplier. Earlier this was not possible. Earlier means before GST law, this matching and mismatching was not possible because it was done manually by humans. You understand? And human may make mistake or human may be corrupted. There are two possibilities, alright? Government has addressed that particular problem without like putting much of, you know, human power. Automatically it can be cross-checked. So system also can go wrong. That's why humans are required. It's not that we will fire whole indirect tax department today. No. Whole indirect tax department, they are hiring more people also. But they will not cross-check line-to-line data now. For line-to-line data, we have created artificial intelligence. Okay? Yeah? This is the background of input tax credit. Let us start studying input tax credit today. Only one thing that I wanted to tell you guys is that for CS executive, rule number 42 and rule number 43 is not there in your syllabus. I will teach in this chapter rule number 42 and rule number 43. Alright. If other batch allow, then we will do it after completion of my whole day lecture so that CS executive can go home. Okay. That is also possible if other batch allows it. But rule number 42 and rule number 43 is not there in our syllabus, CS syllabus. Okay. It is there in IPCC and CMA syllabus, but it is not expected in exam. Okay. I say itself, they haven't provided the proper, it requires proper guidance, proper exam, like illustrations. Those illustrations are missing in our study material. Alright. That means even they don't know practically, like they haven't created practical situations where that rule has to be applied. And it is little complicated. It has to be complicated. Okay. When I say it is complicated, for you it is complicated. For me it is simplified. Because I had seen worst version in CMAT credit before GST. Alright, so post GST, they had created a little sophisticated version, which is complicated for you, but systematic for us. People who had seen old version, but our ICI has recommended government that, sir, this is little complicated to be followed in practical world, not in exam, but in practical world it is little complicated to be followed. And this is not a good idea to put rule number 42 and 43 applicable in the industry. Then government asks ICI, do you have alternative than this, better alternative than this? Politely, if you have better alternative than this, then please recommend us, we will put that in the system. Hello. And our indirect tax committee, there is the ICI indirect tax committee. ICI has dedicated committee for indirect taxation. They are doing research on that. They may incorporate something which is not there as of now. They are doing research on that. That means rule number 42 and rule number 43 is expected to be changed in near future. Okay. And that's why we don't expect a question on that in exam. But when I say we don't expect, that doesn't mean that it won't come. Sometime in life, unexpected thing happens. Alright. So for syllabus angle, I will teach you those rules. But it is your call whether you wanted to follow it in a detail or you just wanted to read it one or twice and like go for examination. That is your call. Am I clear? So that's the only complicated area we have in this chapter left. Other things are very easy. Alright. They are not that complicated. Here it is very simple to understand. Come on, tell me. Now, section 17. Is what is the heading of section 17? Apportionment and block credit. Apportionment means either it will restrict to some part or it will completely block. Hello? It will restrict to some extent or it will completely block. Sir, why to restrict to some extent and completely block? Because my section 16 has given you basic conditions of availment of credit. Hello. So if you are a registered, yesterday also I ask you, if I am a registered, okay, I am a registered person, alright, but I purchase this clothes, can I take the credit? Come on, tell me, can I take the credit? No. Why no? Sir, because this is not for business purpose. This is not for
business purpose.
That is the apportionment. Please understand, goods and services used partly for business and partly for other purpose. Partly for business and partly for other. Now, if I am a trader, if I am a manufacturer of particular goods, alright, this same product is required at my home also. Do you think that I will go outside and bring it? Hello? If I am a manufacturer or trader of one particular product, so I purchase it. But I did not use it exclusively for business purpose, alright? Some part I use for my personal purpose. Say for example, I am a manufacturer of notebook. My children also need notebook. What will I do? I will just take some notebook from my showroom or shop to home. So some material I use in my business and some for other purpose. Other purpose can be any purpose. It can be personal purpose, it can be donation purpose, it can be any other purpose. We are not concerned about that, but it was not used in business purpose. We wanted is to be used in what? Business. Hello, yesterday I told you, it has to be used in business or further runs of business. That we have discussed yesterday. Sir, so if it is used for any other purpose, then you only tell me. If I purchase 10,000 kg raw material, out of 10,000 kg, 3,000 kg I use for personal purpose and 7,000 kg I use for business purpose. But invoice is same. Invoice is same. This is the same invoice for 10,000 kg. Alright. So if I don't take whole credit, that is also wrong. And if I take whole credit, that is also wrong. I should take proportionate credit, isn't it? I should take proportionate credit. Kitna proportion? What will be the proportion? 70 is to 30, sir. Whatever credit amount is there, 70 is to 30. Why 70 is to 30? Because 70% you use for business purpose and 30% you use for other purpose. So what this particular rule is saying? ITC to be restricted to the input tax attributable to? Simple, no? Are you common sense? Alright? If I use 65% in business, then only 65% ITC you can take. If I use 50% in business, then only 50% you can take. If I use 5% in business, you can use only 5%. If you use 100% in business, you can use 100%. If you use 100% for personal purpose, you will not take any. You understand? Yeah? Sir, that is one thing. Second rule is that I use this in a manufacture of these two products. Now you have to give name to this. Okay, this is taxable. And my blue marker is exempted. This is taxable marker and this is exempted marker. Am I clear? And my red marker is exported marker. Red marker is? This is exported marker. This is taxable marker and this is exempted. What is the difference between all? Okay, this is domestic consumption, so I have to pay tax on this. Alright? This is exempted, so I don't have to pay tax on this. And this is exported. I will not pay tax on this, but still I can take ITC. Alright? Pakka? Now, there are three caps. Can you see these three caps? Forget about balance marker. Three caps. Alright? These three caps. This is exclusively red. That is, this is exclusively in exported. So, no problem about this. I'll get credit of this 100%. Alright? Assume that this is whole blue. Alright? It's not, but assume that this is whole blue. Alright? Exclusively used for which business? Exempted. Exclusively used for exempted. Will I get credit of this? Hello, will I get credit of this? No. Alright, I will not get credit of this because exclusively used in exempted. This is exclusively used in taxable, black cap. Exclusively used in taxable. Will I get credit of this? Yes, I will get credit of this. But when I see at this particular bottom of this particular markers, all markers are white. That means white plastic that I'm bringing, I'm using in all. All means taxable, exempt and exported. Okay, and when I purchased it, I was not knowing how much I will be using in exported, how much I will be using in exempted and how much will I be using in taxable. You understand my problem? See, my problem is not about exclusive. I'm very much clear about exclusive. I'm confused about common. And common means, sir, rule is here. Goods and services used partly for taxable, including zero rated supply. ZRS means? That means these two. You understand these two? Hello. Taxable and zero rated. Zero rated is not taxable, but still we are giving credit for zero rated supply. So goods and supply used partly for taxable, including zero rated supply, and partly for exempted supply. Partly for zero rated and partly for exempted. Then what will happen? You tell me. I have to restrict this or this? Hello? I have to restrict this to marker or this marker? Which one I have to control? This one I have to control. That means this is not available and these two are available. Alright? So restricted to the input tax attributable to what, sir? Taxable supply. That means these two you will get. Hello, these two will get and this one you will not get. If I take a ratio here, so 66.67% you will get and 33.33% you will not get. One third you should not get, two third you should get. Hello, yeah. So this is also not that difficult, it's okay. Here, interesting thing is that this definition of exempted supply is very interesting. Alright, You already know one definition of exempted supply. Exempted supply includes nil rated supply, nil. Do you remember? Exempted supply includes nil rated supply. It also includes 100% wholly exempted supply through exemption notification. It also includes non-taxable supply. Hello, I have taught you this. Exempted supply definition says exempted supply includes three items. Which three items? Nil rated. Hello, nil rated. Second, wholly exempted. And third, even non-taxable. So I told you, even petroleum product. Where will I'll remind you where we have written the definition. In composition levy. In composition levy, aggregate turnover includes exempted supply. Hello, in composition levy, there is a definition of aggregate turnover. Aggregate turnover includes taxable turnover as well as exempted turnover. And in exempted, we have written three items. Exempted include nil rated, wholly exempted, and non-taxable. That means when petroleum is included. Hello. That definition is applicable in other sections. Registration section. Please understand that definition applicable is registration section and that composition section. Here we are having different definition of exempted supply. So whatever you understand naturally, that is same definition here. Apart from that, 2-3 extra items are included in that definition. And the definition is exclusively written for this chapter. Hello. This definition of exempted supply is exclusively written for this section. Section 17, subsection 2. Here they have used word exempted supply. Am I clear? So what do you mean by exempted supply here means, sir, exempted supply, whatever you know already, that is there, still there. Alright. That means three items are already there. Which three items? Nil rated, wholly exempted, and non-taxable. Apart from that, three more items they are including here in exempted. And in interesting the items. First, supply under RCM. Supply under RCM. That means this supply is under RCM. This supply is under RCM. That means am I responsible to pay tax? No, who will pay tax? Buyer. Buyer will be paying taxes. I'm a lawyer. Okay. On my services, who will pay tax? Business entity. Should I take input tax credit? You tell me, am I eligible to take input tax credit? I might be registered, but should I take input tax credit? No, because you are not going to pay tax. That's why how will you take that particular credit? And why will you take that particular credit? You understand? Yeah. So they are saying if my supply is taxable, my supply is not exempt. Hello, technically my supply advocate services is taxable, but they are taxable under which charge? Reverse charge. And that's why I should not be taking input tax credit, and this section is restricting me. You can see they are saying if your supply is under RCM, then it is included in exempted, and then this section will restrict that particular input tax credit. Okay, whatever is whatever